Hello everyone, this is Professor Amar Bakodi from Department of Civil Engineering. So today we are going to study about the intake structures of the subject Water Supply and Treatment Engineering Module 5. Intake structures. So the basic function of an intake structure is to help in safely withdrawing the water from the source and then discharge this water into the withdrawal conduit, through which it reaches the water treatment plant. It is constructed at the entrance of the withdrawal pipe and thereby protecting it from clogging it by debris. Sometimes from the reservoirs where the gravity flow is possible, water is directly transmitted to the treatment through these intake structures. If the gravity flow is not possible, then the water entering these intake structures is lifted by pumps and then it is taken to the treatment plant. So let us understand what these things are, what introduction we are getting this. So first thing, the basic function of an intake structure is to safely withdraw the water from, let us say this is the river. You need to take this water from river and you need to give it to the treatment plant. So from there, basically you can distribute it through the entire city. Okay, so if these are the houses, something like that. So this is how your entire system works, water supply system works. So where your intake structures will come into picture is, intake structure has its significance over here. So here what it actually wants to do, it wants to actually make sure that, so safely withdraw the water from the river, canal, reservoir, whatever that water source may be, and then shift it to the water treatment plant. So that is the major work of a intake structure. Now the second thing is, so intake structure is nothing but basically you can just put a pipe there and you can suck the water in and you can give it to the water treatment plant. But unfortunately, if you do that, what may be the difficulty is, if any debris are present in this surface water, then that may clog the entrance of this particular inlet pipe. So that's why these intake structures are nothing but constructed with concrete or machinery, and these will help in basically avoiding these clogging process. Okay, and lastly, sometimes the reservoirs where gravity flow is possible. So what do you mean by that is, I'll just try to rub this in. Okay, so if you check out, imagine I have a reservoir somewhere here. Okay, so this is my reservoir and my land profile is something like this. So here I have stored my water. Okay, this is my water source. So here if I place that intake structure, okay, in coming slides you are going to see what kind of intake structures we have. Just in general, if we have here, so the water can be safely withdrawn from the reservoir to this intake structure, and from here, if the treatment plant is somewhere located here, then what they will do, even if the gravity flow is possible, so directly from this intake structure they will make a pipeline where through gravity the water will directly enter into the treatment plant. If this is not the scenario, if imagine the ground is something like this, so you have your water treatment plant at a higher elevation, so at that point of time what you will do, so in this intake structure you will fix up a pump. Okay, so through this pump, first you will increase the head of water, then you can shift it to a higher elevation. That is, in simpler terms, you can pump this intake water into the treatment plant. So this is how this particular intake structure's basic working is. Okay, now selecting the location of a intake structure. Now if you see, the site should be nearer to the treatment plant to reduce the conveyance cost. So this is the first part of it. Second is, intake must be located in a purer zone of source so that the best quality of water is withdrawn from the source to reduce the load on the treatment plant. Intake must never be located in the vicinity of the wastewater disposal point. So obviously, if you are doing that, then the contaminant, more polluted water will be entering into your intake structure, then that is not good for your treatment. Intake must never be located near the navigation channel so as to reduce the chances of pollution due to the waste discharge from the ships. So from the ships or navigation channels, basically you may have few of the oil or any of the disposal or a waste material that has been dumped from these navigational ships into those channels. So even if you withdraw the water from there, then it is going to become difficult for you to treat. The site should be such that to permit greater water withdrawal of water if required in future. That is, right now you are going to design this particular intake structure for one particular intake capacity. If in future if you want to expand that, then there should be a scope or the place should be such that even the greater water withdrawal can be achieved with the same place. So such place should be identified for the intake structure location. Intake must be located at a place from where it can withdraw water even during the driest of the period. That is, because if you can check out, only the northern region rivers what we have are perennial rivers, whereas most of the central and southern rivers what we have are basically non-perennial rivers. That is, only when the rain comes, so for that 4 months basically they will be flowing. Apart from that, most of the time they will be dried out. So your intake structure should be such that even in the driest of period, so the water should be able to withdrawn from that. So that is where the depth of flow is more, or else where the bed level is at its minimum. So with certain restrictions, that intake should be placed over there, so that you can withdraw the water even in the very least or else driest period. The intake site should remain easily accessible even during the floods and should not get flooded. So again, this is one more important parameter. So here also, if the flood is there, so in the rainy season, if the discharge is more, if the runoff is more, if the depth of flow becomes more at that point of time, even at that point, this site or this particular intake structure should be able to be visitable. So why we need that is because we have few of the equipment. So as and when we study regarding what type of intake structures we have, you can check out, there are different ways in which you can actually control this intake. So to access or else to have that control over the intake or inlet of that water, we need to have the access to this intake structure all the time, that is even during the floods. In the meandering rivers, the intake should not be located on the curves or at least on sharp curves. That is, in meandering rivers, what will happen? Meandering rivers, I hope you know that. Meandering river is something like this. It will not flow in a fixed direction. So it will usually be twisting. So imagine 1 year if it is like this flowing, so next year because of the erosion which may occur at this zone, so the entire flow pattern may change. So in another 5 years the same thing may become like this. So you can check out, so because of that meandering river will be there because of the erosion at the banks. And here, as and when these banks are being eroded, your water path will change. So that's why whenever you want to locate these intake structures in a meandering river, that should not be placed in this corners, because there is always a possibility that the flow pattern of this will change. So as and when the flow pattern change, you cannot go on shifting these intake structures. So that's why, so it should not be placed in the corners or sharp curves of the meandering rivers. Type of intake structures. So we have simple submerged intake structures, then we have intake towers, what we call it, then we have medium sized river intake structures, then we have canal intakes, then we have intakes for sluice ways of the dams. So these are the basic classification of intake structures. So the first one is submerged intake structure. So the submerged intake structure, it is the simplest and the most basic intake structure what we are going to have. So if you check out here, this is the riverbed which is there, okay, and this is the bank of that, yeah, and your intake structure is located over here. Yeah. So even though the intake structure is located on the land part of it, land mass of it, but there is an inlet pipe which is there inside this river or else in this water. Okay. What will happen? So here you can check out, we have bar screens on top here. Water will enter into this. Okay. since the length will be more, there will be some flexible joint. Even if any disturbance is there, this flexible joint can take care of that movement. So the water can enter into this chamber, intake chamber, right? So here again you will have your strainer, that is to filter the water. Even in any case, if debris have passed through even this filter or screen, bar screen, basically here we don't want that to go into the pipeline. So that's why we have the strainer here. So this strainer will be similar to what your regular pumps in your household, what they have. So the same thing will be there. And here we are going to have our pump. So from this water through this pump will be elevated and it will be taken to the treatment plant. So this is one of the simplest submerged intake structures, what we are going to call it. So let us see what all components it has. Okay. So first part is this one. We have this chamber, intake chamber, right? Then we have pump system so that we can lift that water. Now, if I just try to show it here, imagine this is a river. Okay. And on this river bank, basically you have your intake structure. Okay. So the water needs to come from this river to the intake structure. So you are not just putting a pipe. So what you are doing? So here you are actually providing a base concrete. So bed concrete is available here. Why they provide this bed concrete is because your pipe should not get disturbed. So wherever you place it, the placement should be such that in the factors considering, we have already seen ki this should withdraw water even with the lowest water level, right? So that's why we need to make sure that this pipeline is not moving. So that's why we are going to provide what? Your concrete base material. So once this is fixed, in that you are going to put your pipeline. Yeah, and even these joints are maintained in such a way that even if there is any movement or any pressure due to the floods, which will be usually occurring in the rivers, so even that movement can be taken care by this flexible joint and there will not be any leakages. And from there, the water can enter into this chamber. So this is why these particular setup concrete block and with the filtration or screens are required for the submerged intake structure. So once it is there, then from there it will be accessible. And even in case of flood, imagine the maximum flood level is somewhere like here. So even at that point of time, you need to be able to access this part. Why you need to express? Because you have your pumping system, or even in the future you have some of the gates over here. So even gates can be provided so that opening and closing of that, these gates arrangements will be made up in this part only. So that's why even in the flood duration, you should be able to have access to this part of the intake structure. Okay, so let us have the explanation on that. The simple concrete block supporting the starting end of the withdrawal pipe. So you have this part, the cropped portion of previous figure, what you have seen, covered by screen to prevent the entry of debris, etc. So these screens, bar screens, will help you in that. Chances of siltation. So elevated 2 to 2.5 meters above the intake bed level to avoid any silt. So you can check out here, the bed level of river is somewhere here. If you check out, the bed level of river is somewhere here, right? But the intake of that is, or our opening of the mouth is a bit higher than this. So this opening will be usually 2 to 2.5 meter higher than the bed level. Why? Because in the bed level you may have lot of silts that will be transporting. So keeping this 2 to 2.5 meter higher will give us a provision of clearer water that will enter into our bar screen. They are cheap, so, and do not obstruct navigation. So since there is no mooring part or anything, so basically they will be hidden under the water and they will not cause any much obstructions. Widely used for small water supply projects, drawing water from streams or lakes, having little change in water level throughout the year. So since here, as I have previously told, there are no gates which are available here. So this kind of simple submerged intake structure is very useful for taking water from streams or lakes where the water level throughout the year will not change. If the water level is changing too much, then this is not feasible, right? So if it is not varying, then this simple things can be done, or else we have other intake structures. If the water level is varying throughout the year, so we can use different types of intake structures what we have. Now, limitation for this is not easily accessible for cleaning and repairing. So In case if the situation is not proper, if the water level is high, or basically these kind of situations where the water level will remain same throughout the year. So at that point of time, if you want to clean the interior of the intake well, which was there in the previous slide, so then that one become a bit difficult because that is not easily accessible over there. So similarly, the same thing you can check out. Here you have what I can say, instead of this bar screen, what we have, there is one more way is rock filled timber crib submerged intake. So here the entire scenario from this point onwards will remain same as we have seen in the previous slide. But the only thing, instead of these bars over here, what they have is they have a small chamber which is built up. And this chamber is covered by what? Your rocks, your boulders which are there, right? And these boulders are again covered by your timbers or logs which are there. Okay, instead of a simple bar, you have such thing, and on top you have bar screen. So the water will enter from here, it is going to first stay here, the water level here will increase, and then it is going to pass through this pipeline to the intake well. So till this point, as I said, it is different. So it is just a simple submerged intake, whereas this is what we call it as a rock filled timber crib submerged well. So this is what is meant by this one. Intake towers. So they are widely used on large water supply projects, drawing water from rivers or reservoirs having a large change in water level. That is, the previous case the water level should be same, whereas here if the water level is changing, you can go for intake towers, what we call it. Okay, gate controlled openings and ports are provided at various levels in these concrete towers to regulate the flow of water. So as I told you in the previously, here there was no gate or ports through which the water can enter. So whatever the water was there in the river, everything was able to enter into your well. Whereas here it is not the case. You can actually control the depth at which you want to the water to enter into your chamber. So even that can be controlled over here. If the entry ports are submerged at all levels, there is no problem of any clogging or damage by debris. The reason is, since if all the ports are being covered, so that indicates the depth of flow is more. Where there are no debris, only that particular port can be opened, and in turn that water can be entered into your intake well. Okay, there are two major types of intake towers which are available. So one is wet intake tower and the second one is dry intake tower. So let us see what these are. So first let us understand what about the dry intake towers. So the water is directly drawn into the withdrawal conduit through the gated entry ports. So it is quite similar to your submerged intakes, but with a variation or with the advancement of ports through which you can actually control the depth of water through which that water should enter into your intake chamber. It has no water inside the tower if the gates are closed. That is, the water, there will not be any existing water which can be remain in that well if all the ports of this intake tower are closed. When the entry ports are closed, a dry intake tower will be subjected to additional buoyant forces. That is, in the next slide, once we check out the figure, that time I am going to explain about this. Now hence, it must be of heavier construction than the wet intake tower. So in wet intake tower, usually what will happen is you will have your water inside the intake structure whether the gates are open or closed. So that's why the water pressure surrounding that intake structure will be less in case of wet intake tower. Whereas in a dry intake tower, when the gates or ports are closed, there is no way the water can enter into your intake well. So that's why the construction of that well needs to be of a sturdier material, or the thickness of those walls or whatever peripheral materials what we are going to use should be much more greater when I compare it with the wet intake tower. So they are useful since water can be withdrawn from any selected level of the reservoir by opening the port at that level. So Just now in the first point, what I have explained, the same thing is mentioned over here. Okay. Now let us see this dry intake tower. So what all components we have? So you can check out, this is your reservoir level, what you have. This is the water in the reservoir. Okay. So directly, instead of having a pipe at one end and intake tower at the other end, so this entire structure itself is there in that water itself. Okay, I'll just delete this. Right. So because of that, what will happen? The depth of flow is over here. The water stored level is over here, and these are the ports. Four ports you can check out. Yeah, these are the four ports which are available. So these ports can be opened at any point of time. So in this figure, basically there are only two gates which have been shown, one and two. Okay, but usually there will be individual gates for individual ports. Okay, so if I just need to show you this, if I put the gate somewhere here, something like this, yeah, so there will not be any entry of water into this intake tower, right? Because I'm blocking all the entrance. So at that point of time, now wherever the debris are not there, wherever I feel the water is of much purer quality, or where the contaminants or suspended solids or debris are less, I can only lift up that part of what I can say gate. For example, here if it is not there, so I'll only open this one. So the water can basically enter into only this particular entry port. So remaining entry ports will be blocked up. So this is one basic advantage of this. Now the second thing is, if I just try to show it with respect to a river, okay, imagine this is a river. Okay, so if my intake structure is located somewhere here, okay, so if I just take the section of all this, and if I look from this end, this is what is being visible to us right now. Okay, so we have us, and this is basically the river. Yeah, and this line is indicating the end of that river, or else the banks of that river. So this part as well as this part is going to be the banks of river, whereas this is the width of the river, and this is where your intake structure is located. Now you can check out in this, since it is not intake structure is not located on the bank of that river, so it is already there in the river bed itself. So at that point of time, the height of this control room which is there, that is going to become very important, because here only you have your mechanism to open and close the gates through which you can enter the water. Now how these will be usually constructed, it is you will take the maximum flood level of this river for the known time, and then you are going to construct this particular platform or room beyond, or else in a much greater height than that of that particular maximum flood level what you have. So based on that, you can be assured that the water will not reach, to an approximation basically. This will be safe even in case of floods. Okay, and from here basically there will be a platform that will be connecting this to the side of the bank, so that even because you need to access this room, control room, from the banks itself, right? So there will be usually a step or a staircase or a platform through which you can actually access this bank of the river, where you can basically control this. Now the second point is, here as they told, even if the depth of flow is varying, so right now the depth of flow is more, so that's why you can have any of the four ports with which the water can enter. If the water level is somewhere here, imagine this. Okay, so at that point of time, whether you keep these open or closed, it doesn't matter, the top two ports, that time the water can enter into the bottom ports whenever you open that valve. Okay, so that's why these opening ports will help us to or else give us the access to control the flow of water, from what depth we should have that water inlet into our system. So this is about the dry intake tower. Wet intake towers. It consists of a concrete circular shell filled with water up to a reservoir level, and has a vertical inside shaft which is connected to the withdrawal pipe. Okay, so what we have seen in dry intake structure, it will be similar to that, but with a bit of modification. The withdrawal pipe may laid over the bed of the rivers, or may be in the form of a tunnels below the river bed. So it can be on top of that river bed or below the river bed. Openings are made into the outer concrete shell as well as into the inner concrete shell. So here we have two sections where the water can be allowed in. So in the next slide, in the figure, we are going to have more discussion on this. The gates are usually placed on the shaft so as to control the flow of water into the shaft and the withdrawal conduit. That is, the flow of control is also here with the help of those particular gates. The water coming out of the withdrawal pipe may be taken to the pump house for a lift if treatment plant is at a higher elevation, what I have explained in the first slide, or it may be directly taken to the treatment plant if it is at a lower elevation. So this is just a basic points for the wet intake towers. Now let us see regarding the figure and discuss on how the wet intake towers work. You can see this is the wet intake tower. Okay. So here you can see, if I compare this with the dry intake tower, here we have two chambers. Okay, right now you may see it as three, but if I draw it, so it will be something like this. You have outer shell, you have inner shell. Okay, when you cut it over like this, and if you try to wash it like this, okay, here you are seeing this opening, so that is nothing but this central portion. Yeah, and whatever this region is there on both the sides, right? So those things itself are visible like these sections. So don't confuse this. So you have only two concentric circles basically. One is the outer circle, and then you have an inner circle. And when you cut it vertically and view it, so you are going to see something like this. I hope it is clear for you. Now, keeping this clear, okay, we'll go about how this will work. Okay, so first thing you can check out, so this is one opening port, this is second opening port, this is third opening port, and this is fourth opening port. So in the outer shell, what we have over here, we have four opening ports which have been seen over here. Basically these ports will be available throughout the periphery, so only in section you are actually seeing four, but these ports will be available throughout the periphery or circumference of that particular unit. Okay, now you can check out, there is no gates which are provided neither inside nor outside, so these are always open. I hope you are getting this. Just for the sake of explanation, I am going to say it has only four outer opening ports, even though it will have more in real. These are always open, there is no control over the water flow inside. So because of that, what will happen, this outer edge or else outer section or a part of that will always be filled with water. That is first point. Now if you check out the second point over here, the inner circle or inner chamber, what it has again four ports. Okay, and for these ports you can check out, here we have the gates. Here we have the gate. So what will happen here? So if the ports are more, the outer ports, they don't have the gate. So that's why the water can be allowed at any point of time. You don't have the control over here, but you can control the flow of water in this inside chamber through these particular gates which are available. Okay, so here one more thing, when I compare it with the dry intake towers over here, check it out. Even if I close all these four, let us take some purple. Okay, so imagine I am going to close all these inside four openings which are there through the gates. Okay, I am closing these. At that point of time, what will happen, there will not be any water inside this pipeline because I am closing all the four points of entry, but here the water will always exist in the outside chambers. I hope you are getting that. So in the outside chamber, the water will always exist because you don't have any gates to control the flow of water. So that's why what will happen, here you can check out, the thickness of the walls over here is less when I compare it with the dry intake tower, because here the water pressure will be there only from this width which is available. Yeah, so this width which is available, right? So the water pressure will be available only for this, because the water is already standing over here. So that's why instead of having a single thick wall over here, you have thinner walls because of this additional water which is standing in the outer circle of this structure. So that is the major difference. So here the walls can be of a smaller section, whereas for dry intake towers it needs to be of a thicker section, which is going to be there. Now based on these entry ports, again similar to the dry intake towers, you can actually decide the depth of flow over here. So at what depth you want the water to get in, you can control that with the help of these gates. So that is one advantage what you have. And second thing is, again, you have your control room on top. So again, if you have your river something like this, if it is located here, so there will be a platform through which you can actually access this and control your gates. And as well as if this, as in the previous slide it is mentioned, if the treatment plant is at a lower elevation, the same water pipeline will be taken directly through gravity to that point. If it is at a higher elevation, the water will be again pumped up to the treatment plant. So this is how your wet intake towers work. Now the third one, what we have is medium sized river intake structures. Okay, they are generally constructed for withdrawing water from almost all rivers. These can be classified again into two types. One is twin well type intake structure and the second one is single well type intake structure. So let us see in detail regarding these. So first, let us take up with the twin well type intakes. They are constructed on almost all types of rivers where the river water hugs the river bank. A typical river intake structure consists of three components. One is an intake well, second one an inlet pipe or intake pipe what we call it, and the third one is a jack well where the water is initially stored or maintained. The inlet well is usually circular in cross section and is made up of machinery or concrete. The inlet pipe connects the inlet well with the jack well. It has a minimum diameter of 45 cm laid at a slope of 1 in 200. Flow velocity through this will be less than 1.2 meters per second. The water entering the jack well is lifted up by the pumps and fed into the rising main. The jack well should be founded on a hard strata with a bearing capacity more than 450 kN per meter square. Right? So these are the basic components of your intake wells. So you can see basically it has an intake inlet well, then inlet pipe and then a jack well. So in simplest of terms, if I need to say a pipe, okay, and a well, intake well initially it is there, then a pipe, and then through this we have something called as jack well. So both these are used for storing water only, but inlet well is just a beginning part and jack well is basically where the water will be pumped through the water treatment plant. Okay, let us see the figure in the next slide. Okay, so this is your twin well type intake. Okay, so here you can check it out. This is your bed of the river. Okay, so this is the bank of the river. So this dotted line is indicating the level of land. Okay, so it is improving over here. So here what has happened, it is what I can say, advanced version of your intake towers. Okay, so intake wells are nothing but the advanced version of intake towers. So at that point of time, we have a well here, but there is no pumping or anything over here, just a well. Okay, but these things, as previously mentioned, you need to have a platform to come into this particular well. So that is itself is shown over here. Okay, now here if you check out, we have control room and this is nothing but your inlet well or else inlet chamber. Again, you have ports, you have a gate for that. So basically you can control at which point the water can enter into this. And apart from that, one more additional feature what it has is it has a fine screen bar over here. So whatever the larger quantum of debris are there, that can be taken here only, or else they can be segregated here only, and only the much clearer water is going to enter here, and then it is going to enter into this sump well or jack well where the water is again being stored. So this is nothing but the inlet pipe or conduit pipe which is going to be there. Now from this jack well or sump well, again you have a pump system and you have a strainer where the again the water will be filtered before it gets pumped up. So from there it will be taken to the treatment plant or to the city or wherever it is required. Here you can check it out. If I just need to show it in terms of the plan, you have your river something like this. So here you have your intake well, then you have your pipe, then you have your jack well over here. The reason this is there is here the main pumping will be occurring from this jack well or this part. Okay, so even in case if the things go wrong, right, so in case of flood, you can make sure that you are going to fix up a level from where the water is going to enter, and even if this gets flooded, there is no need for you to worry because here there is nothing much to do that. So main pumping will be done through this jack well. So you need to make sure that wherever this pumping room is stationed, it should be always above the maximum flood level which is going to be there. Okay, so this is how the twin well type intake of works. Now the next one is your single well type intakes. So here no inlet well and inlet pipe in this type of river intake. So there we have two sections, so here we'll have only one section. Opening or ports fitted with bar screens are provided in the jack well itself. So in a single structure all those things are provided. The sediment entering will usually be less since clearer water will enter to the takeoff channel. So this part I'll explain with a figure which is going to be there in the next slide. The silt entering the jack well will partly settle down in the bottom silt zone of the jack well or may be lifted up with the pumped water since pumps can easily lift the sedimentary water. So the silt entering the jack well will partly settle down in the bottom silting zone of the jack well or may be lifted up with the pumped water since pumps can easily lift even the sedimented water. So the new ones which are there. Okay. The jack well can be periodically cleaned manually by stopping the water entry into the well. So even we can do those kind of things. Okay, now this is the figure for single intake structure. Now you can check out, this is your riverbed level and it may go something like this. So this is the bank. So instead of having that two wells, here the entire section or works are being done in a single one. Okay, so here you can check out, this is the maximum flood level what I was talking about. So they have already studied. So your platform is actually a bit above than this maximum flood level. Okay. So here again you have ports for the entry of water. So whichever water you want, you can operate these ports and let that water in over here. So once the water comes here, so first because the velocity is less, so whatever the sediments are being entered here, the second point, what I was trying to explain in the previous slide, basically those sedimented particles can settle down here. Okay, those particles usually will be settled down here. And if any case, if these particles are not being settled down, then through this strainer with these pumps, even these silted water can be pumped out. So the new centrifugal pumps, what we have of larger capacity are basically resistance to even the silt application. So even they can actually lift the water with silted content. So that can be happen over here. Now this is basically sump, and if you want to clean that, so basically cleaning means removal of this sludge or settled sediment. So that can be done on a fixed time interval so that even this sediment can be controlled basically. So this is how your single well type of intakes works. Now the next one what we have is we call it as canal intakes. So first let us understand what this is. Okay, so you can check out, this is the ground level. Okay, this is the ground level of the canal. So you have one side of that level here, this is the embankment what we have. So usually how the canals are going to be in something like this. Yeah, right now if you check out my figure which is there is our particular intake well is located somewhere here, something like this. It is located something like this. So here your water is flowing. I guess you can imagine this. So keeping this point in mind, so let us come to this. So here we have FSL, that is full supply level, right? So this is minimum water level and this is normal water level. So during the normal operation condition, this is the depth of water that is maintained in the canal. So here also you have ports at a various depth, again you have screens, so you can control the flow of water, and once it comes here, it is going to remain stagnant, and from there basically through this embankment only you can have that pipeline. So here also you can see basically this all section is your embankment. This is where your entire soil is being filled up, right? So through that soil itself basically you can have this intake, and again you can have your fine screen on top so that to prevent entry of debris, and the same water can be taken out. If again if needed it will be pumped up, if not the water treatment plant is at a lower elevation, it can be directly taken through the gravity. So this is how a simple canal intake works. So all these things you can check out. Again, these control room which are available will be always above the full supply level, so that it will be always accessible through even through this foot connection, as it is mentioned over here, even you can access that. So this is valve operating mechanism, so wherever you want this water to enter into your stream, water treatment plant, whenever you want to pump it or else whenever you want to supply it over there, that time you can basically open this and you can allow the water in. So this is how a canal intake works. Now similarly we have intake for a sluice ways of dam. Okay, so first let us understand what is a sluice ways. So already you have completed your extensive survey. So there if you remember, we have done something called as sluice gates or surplus weir or something, right? So what do you mean by that sluice gate? I'll try to just write this small figure over here. Imagine this is your dam, okay, this is the upstream side, this is the level, yeah. So excess water usually what will be there, so that will be taken to a corner, side of this weir, and we call that as surplus weir. So excess water which is there can be taken off through that surplus weir. If you want to take the water from this upstream side to the downstream side safely for any of the usage, whether it is irrigation, water supply or anything, basically you will have one pipeline over here. If you remember in our survey, basically where we have gone, you can see these kind of first day what visit you have done near Saugaon. So there you can actually see these gates, right? So from the upstream side through this, if you open the gate over here, the water will enter, yeah, and this can be discharged over here. So this is nothing but your sluice pipe, and these gates are called as sluice gates. I hope it is clear now. So keeping that in mind, let us rub off this first. Okay, so keeping that in mind, now let us come back to here. So you can check out this dotted line is nothing but indicating a side, upstream side of your dam. So whatever I had drawn it over here, yeah, so this part is nothing but this part. Okay, now here only I have my sluice way. So this is my entire structure which I have, okay, and whatever the pipe I told, the sluice pipe, right? So that pipe is indicated over here. This is nothing but that pipe. Now if you check out, this is the maximum water level, this is the normal water level, and this is the minimum water level what we have. So you have entry ports at different heights. So here also you can actually control the outlet valves and at what height you want the water to enter into your intake pipe. So even that can be controlled as we are doing in the previous cases. So once it is, you can take the water from the required water level, and from here basically you are going to take it to the downstream side. So again this can be taken to the directly water supply, or it can be taken to the water treatment plant, so based on its requirement. So this is how your intake for sluice ways of dam works. So instead of having a simple intake, you are going to have this kind of structure where the level of water through which you want to take that water into your inlet pipe can be controlled over here. Now the next one what we have is intake for sluice ways of dam. So again this is one more way. So in the previous case your dam was something like this, yeah, and your structure was in the upstream side, so it was away from the body of that dam. So similarly in this, what is happening? Your entire structure is built within the body of the dam. Okay, here your entire structure is built within the body of the dam. So this is the second type of sluice way for intakes for dams. So here also you can check out normal pool level, you have minimal pool level, you have different levels at which you can let the water in. So instead of having that previous case, we had that section over here. Instead of that, right now I am having it within the body of the dam. And once it is collected through the again sluice pipe, I am going to take it to the other side. So this is how your intake for sluice ways of dams work. This is the second type. And the last one, so the last one right now, intakes for sluice ways of dam again. So here you can check out, instead of keeping this entirely inside this body, so even the height of this particular control room is more. Along with that, one more additional thing what you can see here is, it is a combination. So first thing, for the sake of safety, they have added this impervious core. So all these will be basically the structural integrity. To maintain that structural integrity of the dams, we are going to have these sections that will be built up. So all these are precautionary measures, so that is a different topic. But to concentrate on the present scenario, we'll have our intake structure located here. You have again different levels at which you can take the water, right? So here there is a general way of taking the water to the downstream side. So you have your grated structure over here, and through this sluice pipe basically you can take it to the downstream side. If along with that, okay, you can have again different elevations that can be controlled. So here again you have your valves, pumps, everything, so with which you can actually control the water entry over here. So the water will not be, basically it will be open to atmosphere, so atmospheric pressure will itself will be there, so whatever the outside water level will be there will be maintained. And basically here the gate or else the valve which is going to be there, through that you can actually control the quantum of water that will be taking to the downstream side. So all these are what the different types of intake structures. So again I'll repeat, so these intake structures what we are making, or else the basic utilization of these intake structures, are to make sure that the water from the any of the sources, whether it is a river, pond, lake, stream, anything, that should be taken to the water treatment plant. So the water should be safely withdrawn at all the point of time. So to help that withdrawal, we are going to use these intakes. Okay, so these are the various types of intakes what we have studied for this lesson. Fine, so let us see what all things have been covered here. So in this collection and conveyance of water part, we have done with intake structures, type of intakes, factors to be considered for selection of intake structures. So this first part of this fifth module is covered in this particular class. So in the next class, we'll check out with the pumps, pipes, as well as various other aspects. Thank you.